What will you write? No, you tell him strictly attend.
Yes, sir.
Irrespective of the exam or no exam.
No.
No, no. See, this is meant for topics we have selected for his only. No exams, repeated, ask like that.
Yes, sir.
Sandeep, ring up and tell him to come.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Okay, sir. We'll start.
You give him a call at 10. Start. Okay, Raju, start.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Today, the topic for the seminar is left ventricular assist devices. This is a very important question which has been asked in the last 3-4 years many times, more than half a dozen times. So we are taking up this topic. For the introduction, problem statement, heart failure, the incidence and prevalence is increasing at an epidemic proportion in the last one decade. And this epidemic is primarily due to the improved survival in patients with heart failure and the progressive aging of the population, which was a contributory finding to this increase in the number of patients with heart failure.
What are the two important causes of heart failure after the age of 60?
Coronary artery disease and hypertension.
Yes, hypertension and ischemic heart disease are the two major causes. Nearly 95% of the patients belong to that after the age of 60, 65. Then comes other degenerative aortic wall disease or some hypertension, all those things like that. So that's why control of hypertension and management of ischemic. See, if they ask you prevention of heart failure, see, sometimes it was asked, it can be asked, what are the steps you take to prevent heart failure? Then you have to mention that epidemiologically you give what is the statistics, which are the common causes, and then you have to tell that you have to prevent that. Say hypertension should be better controlled, ischemic heart disease should be early recognition and management like that. Then other disorders like that. See, anyhow, all our disorders, everything are different, especially in our tropical countries. Still, it is one of the common causes in the young and middle-aged group. But the elderly age group, after the age of 60 years, the two common causes are hypertension and ischemic heart disease.
In USA alone, with the current population of 32.82 crore, there is around 0.5 crore population approximately are suffering from heart failure, with an incidence of approximately 6.5 lakh new cases annually with suffering from heart failure, and over a million in annual hospital with admissions, and greater than 3 lakhs deaths per year with secondary to heart failure, and approximately 50% of all the cases are having HFRAF with failure with reduced ejection fraction, and probably 10% have advanced symptoms of NIHA 3 and NIHA class 4. And patients with heart failure are usually having poor prognosis, low survival, and severely diminished quality of life. And current modes of management are primarily medical management, which primarily helps in ameliorating the symptoms but cannot slow the disease progression up to MR. And CRT and
can slow
disease progression, sir. CRT and pharmacological interventions are of limited benefit, and definitive therapy for end stage heart failure is always cardiac transplantation, but only small number of patients can get cardiac transplantation because of the lack of suitable donors. So this led to the development of the idea for the development of circulatory supportive devices, which are potentially capable of permanent mechanical support. And for the first time, first implementation of an LVAD, or that is left ventricular assist devices, as a bridge to transplantation was performed by Philip Poyer in the year 1984. And the common terminologies to be understood before understanding the topic are bridge to recovery, that is, an LVAD is used in patients with heart failure with potentially reversible cause, such as acute myocardial infarction, acute myocarditis, post-cardiotomy, or a cardiogenic shock. Bridge-to-bridge therapy, that's temporary myocardial circulatory support, is continued as a bridge to a long-term LVAD. bridge to transplant where the patient is eligible for heart transplant. In these patients, an alveoid is placed until he gets ready for the cardiac heart transplantation. Destination therapy is the term used for patients with where the recovery or transplant is not feasible. So we keep an alveoid until he goes to and succumbs to end stage to death. Bridge to candidacy, where eligibility is unclear at the time of implant or with multiple comorbidities, and we need to take time to define the adequacy of the requirements for the transplant. And bridge to decision therapy is nothing but the patient with potential for transplant or recovery is unclear.
Actually, this LVS, they were specially heart made. It was thought to be a bridge to transplant. Most of the patients were scheduled for transplant, waiting for receive a donor's organ. So they used to be on this one, but now they said that that's why they changed it, that destination therapy means so that you can continue with that HeartMate or whatever device until whether you get it or not, like that. So actually, Megdi Yacoub is a very famous cardiac surgeon in UK. He's a very famous transplant surgeon, and he also now very popular with this HeartMate destination therapy. So he has advocated that destination therapy is more accepted nowadays rather than think that it is a bridge to transplant.
Next thing, this is itself is asked us and also asked us question DNB exams, that is ENTERMAX. ENTERMAX is nothing but Interagency Registry for Mechanically Assisted Circulatory Support. It was for the first time developed by a North American registry, which was established in the year 2005. It had collected clinical data of patients receiving device therapy to treat advanced heart failure, and it had compiled the data of more than 10,000 patients who had received left ventricular assist devices, and survival of all the patients with continuous flow left ventricular assist device at 1 and 2 years is documented, and it's found to be around 80% at 1 year and 70% at 2 years respectively. And 1 year survival for destination therapy patient using LVAD is around 75%.
So this is, I think, very important. You have to remember that this trial. Just if you mention that trial, you will get full marks. Yeah. You need not write all those things. If you say that it has shown that 70 to 85% survival of 1 or 2 years means, say 1 year means, they definitely.
Yes. This is a graph which has been published. It shows that patients who are receiving oral medical therapy will be succumbing to death. Around 75% of them will go to death at the time of 12 months around 92% will go to death around 24 months. Whereas
don't say like that.
Okay, sir. The survival is
that's only not a good terminology.
Yes, sir. Okay. The survival at 12 months is 25% in oral medical therapy, and the survival at 24 months is 8%.
Okay.
Same when these patients have received LVAD as a destination therapy, is around 68 to 74% in patients who are receiving LVAD and at 1 year, and 58 to 61% who are receiving LVAD at 24 months. And those patients who had received heart transplant, the survival rates at 12 months is around 88% and 84% at 2 years. This shows there is a significant improvement in the survival of patients with who are receiving LVAD as therapy. ENTERMAX profile as reclassified patients into 7 categories. The first one is the critical cardiogenic shock patients who are rapidly crashing and will succumb to death very fast. And second one is the progressive decline of the patient is seen with sliding down of the inotropes. And third one is the patients who are unstable on inotrope, that is dependent inotrope stability. And almost 80% of the left ventricular assist devices are being given or being received by the first three categories. And that too in the first three categories, the second and the third category are the most often patients who can benefit from the LVAD. And fourth one is the resting symptoms, that is persistent advanced symptoms, that is ambulatory. And fifth one is exercise intolerant to minimal activity. Sixth is exercise limited, restricted to minimal activity. And seventh is advanced heart failure. These are the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And this is the first one rapidly crashing, sliding down on the inotrope, stable on inotropes. Excess limited, excess intolerant. This is fourth one is a persistent advanced symptoms, excess intolerant and excess limited. And final one is seven, that is NIHR 3 class symptom, heart failure symptoms. And majority of the patients who received LVADR in between class 2 and class 3. These are the patients who are either fastly sliding down on inotropes or the patients who are stable on inotrope support. And these are the first group of patients who rapidly decline on inotropes are either doesn't give time to for a LVAD placement or usually will have other contraindications for LVAD therapy. And the growing acceptance for using LVAD is usually in the first three groups of Intermax profile. And the 4, 5, 6 will have a limited adoption and currently not approved in 7, that is NIHR class 3 patients. What are mechanical support devices? Mechanical pump design are those that are designed to assist or replace the function of either the left, right or both the ventricles. It decreases the workload of the heart while maintaining the adequate flow and blood pressure. What are the guidelines for initiation of mechanical circulatory support? Timing of initiation is very crucial. Early initiation of LVAD therapy will have a better prognosis than compared with patients who receive mechanical circulatory support at a later time. And the general accepted guidelines are, the indications are, cardiac index less than 1.8 to 2.2 liter per minute per meter square, the systolic blood pressure less than 90, wedge pressure greater than 20, RA pressure greater than 18 to 20 mmHg, and evidence of poor tissue perfusion with associated symptoms like with associated findings of oliguria, mental status changes, or cool extremities. And the general contraindications for mechanical circulatory support are irreversible renal, hepatic, or respiratory failure, severe sepsis, and significant cognitive decline. This is the algorithm for device therapy. First, we need to identify the patient who require ventricular assist device, and we should classify them as CHF refractory to inotropic support or IABP support. Then we need to classify them with those patients who require a short-term LVAD therapy or the patients who require a long-term LVAD therapy. In those patients who require a short-term LVAD therapy, we need to see whether the patient requires as a short-term for a bridge to decision or bridge to recovery. And these patients are usually kept on various extracorporeal LVAD devices such as Abiomed, Tandem Heart or Centrimed, which I'll be explaining in the next few slides. And those patients who require a long-term end-stage, long-term LVAD are again divided into bridge to transplant patients and destination therapy. These are the patients with whom they are planned for a transplant and they will be waiting for the donor to donate a heart for transplantation. Usually in these patients, they keep a heart rate, various LVADs like my HeartMate 2, Micromed, DBK ventricular assist device, Jarvik 2000. And those patients who are not suitable for cardiac transplantation will be given a destination therapy of ventricular assist device. The usual commonly used LVAD is Thoratec HeartMate 1. What are the common indications for ventricular assist? There are three common indications for ventricular assist device. The first one is chronic heart failure. Second one is acute refractory cardiogenic shock, and third one is bridge to recovery. Those patients with heart failure less than ejection fraction of 25%, peak venous oxygen saturations of less than 14 cc per kg per minute, NIHR class 3 for around 60 days, NIHR class 3 or class 4 for around 28 days, who required...
Not venous, volume.
Okay, volume. IABP support for
14 cc per kg per minute is required consumption, oxygen consumption.
Yes.
VO2 is the volume of oxygen consumption.
Yes. And I have 3 or class 4 for 28 days with IABP support requiring at least for 14 days or 2 failed attempts to wean off from IV inotropes. And second is acute cardiogenic shock, refractory cardiogenic shock in patients with acute fulminant myocarditis, acute myocardial infarction with cardiogenic shock, peripartum cardiomyopathy with critical cardiogenic shock, or Takotsubo cardiomyopathy with cardiogenic shock, post-cardiac surgery in patients who are unable to maintain an adequate cardiac support, cardiac output or failure to wean from cardiopulmonary bypass. And the third indication is bridge to recovery, where there will be a therapeutic surgery in small subset. And the principle behind this bridge to recovery is mechanically unloading the left ventricular assist device, which helps in reverse remodeling and ultimately helps in reduction in the chamber size and improvement in the LVS pressure volume relationship. And all the patients who are ultimately having a contraindication for cardiac transplant are, most of them will be the candidates for ventricular assist device according to REMATCH. And the most common contraindication for cardiac transplant are age greater than 65 years, insulin dependent diabetes mellitus with end organ damage, CKD with creatinine concentrations greater than 2.5 milligram per deciliter, and associated comorbidities that portend reduced long-term survival, such as in malignancy, history of stroke, end-stage COPD, or decompensated chronic liver disease. And the usual contraindications for ventricular assist device are active systemic infection, high surgical risk for successful implantation, a recent evolving stroke or neurological deficit, fixed pulmonary or pulmonary portal hypertension, intolerance to anticoagulation, morbid obesity, RV dysfunction, CKD with serum creatinine greater than 3 mg per deciliter, restrictive cardiomyopathy, and significant underlying psychiatric illness or lack of social support. Classification of ventricular assist device is primarily based on four categories. It depends on the based on the pumping mechanism, based on the location of pumping chamber, based on the ventricles that are being supported by the LVAD, and based on the duration of support of the LVAD that is planned. If it is based on the pumping mechanism, they are classified either as a pulsatile and continuous flow. And in continuous flow, they are again divided as axial flow, centrifugal flow, and a combination of both axial and centrifugal flow that is called as mixed system. Based on the location of pumping chamber, it can be either an intracorporeal system or an extracorporeal system. Based on the ventricle that is being supported, it can be either a left ventricular assist device, a right ventricular assist device, and both the ventricles are supported, that is called as biventricular assist devices. And based on the duration of support, it can be taken as a short term or long term. If it is days to weeks, that is considered as short term. If it is months to years, that is called as long term LVAD. The most important preoperative assessment is to find, before keeping an LVAD, that is left ventricular assist device, is to check the right ventricular function and the assessment for seeing that there is no associated RV dysfunction. And others are to see for coronary angiography and right heart catheterization to assess the RA pressure and pulmonary vascular resistance. And echocardiographic examination of our right ventricle should be done to see for any severity or the presence of tricuspid regurgitation, adequacy of RV size, right ventricular ejection fraction, and tricuspid TAPSI lift, TAPSI values to see for right ventricular. What are the components of ventricular assist device? It consists of an outflow graft device. Next is connector. Outflow valve conduit, drive line, inflow valve conduit, inflow cannula, swing ring with cuff. These are all the components of a ventricular assist device. This is I'll just show in the next few slides. The inflow of the blood from the heart will be directly going through the swing ring with cuff into the inflow cannula, where it will be continuing going forward into the conduit, where from the conduit it will be driven outside to the outflow valve conduit through a connector to the outflow graft, which will be connected usually to an ascending aorta or the descending aorta. The components of ventricular assist device, the first one is the electromechanical pumps placed in parallel with the native patient circulation. Inflow cannula that decompresses the ventricular cavity. It can be either an LVAD, it will be inserted into the left ventricular. In an RVAD, it will be inserted into the right ventricle or the right ventricle or the right atrium. In biventricular ventricular assist devices, it will be either originating in both ventricles or the both ventricles.
You tell that diagram clearly again, everyone will remember.
Yes, sir. Sir, next few slides again I will be taking up, sir. Okay. Actually, this one
is all in the subcutaneous plane only. It is no external, this one. That is it.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'll just again neatly show them, sir. Inflow cannula, either a pump provides propulsion of blood. It can be either pulsatile pump that is seen in the first generation left ventricular assist devices, or it can be a non-pulse cell or continuous, which have been in the modern LVADs such as second and third generation left ventricular devices. In the pulse rail devices, the blood is usually driven by a pneumatically or electromechanically driven support. Whereas in a non-pulse cell or continuous, we have a rotor system which drives the blood out of the conduit. The pump is usually implanted. It is a major chunk of the LVAD, which contributes the major weight of the LVAD. It is either implanted extracorporeal or intracorporeal. If it is intracorporeal, that is within the body, it can be either placed within the abdomen or it can be placed in the preperitoneal position or the intra-abdominal position. And outflow cannula returns blood to either the ascending aorta or main pulmonary artery in which ventricle that is decompressing. If it is an LVAD, it directs blood to the ascending aorta. If it is an RVAD, it directs blood to the pulmonary artery. A controller operates pump by receiving and processing information from it. And a percutaneous gyroline is present, which contains the control and the power wires, is tunneled through the skin of the abdominal wall, and it connects device to the external portable driver consisting of electronic or pneumatic control and power supply that may be worn around the waist. So this is a plain diagram. This is the inflow part, this is the pump, and this is the outflow part. And from the pump, we have a percutaneous lead which connects to the controller, and this controller we can control the entire pump, that is the inflow, outflow, and we can almost control all the variables of the LVAD. And from here to the pump, we have two batteries on either side of the shoulder which helps in giving current to the both the controller as well as the pump. And yeah, these are various types of flow that
actually, so actually, this Magdiakub wrote this about this, and he said it's a destination therapy. But the main one word used, I liked it really. He said one of the important problems of this this one is all these devices are the controller is outside now, the motor or whatever it is, all those things. So the tubes have to go through the skin and subcutaneous tissue. So he used the word, the integumental disruption. So integumental means same skin, subcutaneous tissue, deep fascia. That disruption is the one which is the major source of infection. See, that is the major problem of this, all these devices, is the infection. If infection comes, you cannot. You have to replace it again. So that's why used it is. Integumental disruption is the major problem in this, all these assist devices, because this tubing should come out of the skin. So there is a track between the skin to this deep fascia. So that is the one where all the streptococcus, epididymitis, all those things will join, enter and cause infection. So use that terminology, integumental disruption.
This is how a centrifugal pump works, where the fluid comes into the conduit and there will be a circular blade with turbine-like configuration which will be pumping out the fluid out from the conduit. And this is the example of a rotor system which gives an axial flow, where we will have a central rotor surrounded with a central rotor which will be continuously rotating, which helps in driving out the blood from which it comes to the left ventricle. It contains of a the blood flows through the inflow cannula to the rotor. From here, the rotor sends out the blood in a continuous axial flux fashion. This is a comparison. This is how an axial flow machine works, where in which the blood comes through the inflow conduit. A rotor will be continuously rotating like a turbine. It will be continuously rotating in an axial fashion, which lets out the blood in an axial fashion. Whereas here, the blood will be going through the centrifugal machine, centrifugal turbine, which helps in driving out the blood. I will tell what are the advantages of centrifugal flow when compared to axial flow, because the recent LVADs are majority of them are based on the centrifugal flow patterns. Flow across the pump directly depends on the pump speed and afterload across the left ventricular assist device. If the flow is more through the pump, automatically the amount of flow out coming from the pump will be increased. That is directly proportional. In case if the afterload increases on the head of the LVAD, obviously there will be decrease in the output from the conduit. So we need to overcome these disadvantages of LVAD. In order to overcome these disadvantages, they have designed the centrifugal mode when compared to the axial mode, because in axial mode the relationship between the flow and head pressure will be steep and inversely related, because if the afterload is increased in axial systems, automatically the output will come down, whereas in centrifugal flows they are less susceptible to head pressure changes. Hence in axial flows the flow coming out from the left LVAD will be dependent only on the preload, whereas in centrifugal system it will be dependent both on the preload and afterload. Physiology of continuous flow LVAD. These hydrodynamics characteristics of centrifugal pumps translate into a more pulsatile waveform, a more accurate flow estimation, and lower risk of suction events in the setting of dehydration, arrhythmias, or light ventricular failure. And the pulsatility of device is calculated as the pump index. Pump index is nothing but maximum flow minus minimum flow by the average flow, and low pump index suggests as a condition such as hypovolemia or pump obstruction. And usually low arterial pulsatility is seen as a cause for several serious adverse effects of continuous flow LVAD. And LVAD speed modulation is used for antithrombotic cycling to prevent pump thrombosis, and it precludes the formation of zones of recirculation and stenosis within the device. And types of ventricular assist devices, where they can be either short-term devices, which are usually inserted from an extracorporeal system into via percutaneous system into the heart, or there can be a large long-term devices. The commonest percutaneous devices which are used to as LVAD as a short-term devices are Impella and tandem heart. First one is Impella. It is impeller driven axial flow pump capable of pumping around 2.5 liter per minute. And the second one is tandem heart. It is a centrifugal continuous flow pump system. It drains oxygenated blood through a catheter advanced across the interatrial septum to the left atrium and pumps it back to one or both the femoral arteries. This is the Impella. The Impella contains an axial flow system with a rotor. It continuously rotates and helps in unloading the left ventricle around. It helps in giving around 2.5 liter per minute of output and decreases the left ventricular contractility requirement. So this is a small animation.
A heart attack and a heart can't pump, it may be necessary to use one of these left ventricular assist devices. It's a catheter that goes up the femoral artery, pass it up around the aorta, and then we put the catheter across the aortic valve into the left ventricle. At that point, we start a micromotor in the device, and it spins, and when that motor spins, it pulls blood from the left ventricle out into the aorta. It injects it around the aorta to supply blood to the coronary arteries, to the rest of the body, and the other organ systems. The device cannot replace your heart. It's an assist device, so it assists the heart. It can do the work of about half of what the normal heart can do. If there's somebody who has heart failure and is not doing well, and this device can be a life-saving device. We were one of the first ones to use this device early on, and the first ones in Brooklyn to have this device on our shelf. The device is usually taken out.
Next commonly used percutaneous device is tandem heart. It is an extracorporeal system which are comes under various trade names like Biomedicus, Abiomed BBS, Thoratex Intrimac pump blood pump. The major advantages of tandem heart ventricular assist device are: it is widely available, relatively inexpensive, simple and quick implantation can be done, and it may be used both as for a right ventricular assist device or a left ventricular assist device, or it can be used as a part of an ECMO circuit. The major disadvantage of tandem heart is it requires systemic anticoagulation, requires ICU monitoring, and it has limited and the patient will be having limited mobility.
And requiring extracorporeal circulatory support. A growing body of evidence suggests that earlier deployment of support is a critical determinant of success. Early support promotes cardiac recovery. Cardiac Assist has developed a percutaneous extracorporeal circulatory support system the tandem heart system. The tandem heart system can provide up to 5.0 liters per minute of cardiac output for a multitude of patient presentations. Preload reduction and systemic perfusion are achieved through left atrial to femoral artery bypass with access from the femoral venous and arterial system. Oxygenated blood is drawn from the left atrium via a drainage cannula and returned to the systemic circulation via one or two arterial cannulae. The tandem heart can be rapidly inserted in the cath lab or operating room in as little as 30 minutes. Use a standard transseptal puncture.
Next one are the long-term assist devices. Long-term assist devices, as the age-old, can be again classified into age-old first generation or pulsatile flow pumps. The commonly used second generation and continuous flow pumps, and the most recent ones which are out to come into general more common use, that is the third generation or continuous flow pumps. When compared to first generation assist devices, second generation and third generation LV left ventricular devices are smaller in size, more durable, and the output determinants are more from both preload and afterload. When compared to first generation, which was either intra-abdominal or preperitoneal in a pocket under rectus abdomini, second generation are being placed more in an intracardiac or intrathoracic position. And usually there will be only a single moving part in the second generation and third generation LVAD when compared to multiple moving parts in first generation LVAD. The drive lines are thin and flexible in second and third generation, which are thick and less flexible in first generation. And the battery capacity will be of long duration in second and third, and there will be less chance of thrombogenesis in second and third generation because of use of better technology in second and third generation LVADs. This is a schematic diagram. Over the last two decades, the first LVAD that is being used, that is the HeartMate one, it had weighed around 1.1 kg and slowly the weight had come down and with better technological outputs, and now the current devices are around hardly 200 to 200 milligrams. Commonly used is around 280 grams, which was being commonly used these days. These are the various first generation devices. HeartMate XCV, which is an extracorporeal system. Centrimag right ventricular assist devices. Berlin XCOR, it is also an extracorporeal system. Jarvik 7 is a first generation devices which you used to work by a pneumatical system. The commonly used second generation is HeartMate 2, which is a small device when compared to first generation devices. And the latest one is HeartMate 3, which is still smaller and with better flow patterns. I'll be discussing the basic underlying points of first generation, second generation and third generation. The major disadvantage of first generation or pulsatile flow systems is that they require anticoagulation for all the devices. It is very noisy and uncomfortable for the patients because of percutaneous leads, which are large, stiff, and usually they contain air vent channels because they are pneumatically driven. Then they have increased risk of hematomas and high chance of infections as they are large in volume and require extensive surgical dissection. The commonly used first generation or pulsatile flow pumps are HeartMate 1, HeartMate XV-EVE, and NovaCar ventricular assist device. The HeartMate 1 is the first device that is being used, which is made up of titanium or polyurethane diaphragm and has a pusher plate actuator. Cannula is placed at the apex of left ventricle, and blood flows through a dacron conduit to the pump and returns into the dacron outflow graft through another Purkinje wall to the ascending aorta. So they have moving conduits as well as moving valves, and the titanium that is present will help in decreasing the amount of thrombogenesis. This is the first ventricular assist device where we have an apical swing ring with cuff, the inflow cannula, inflow valved conduit, which is a moving part, and this is the major pumping chamber, and again the outflow valved conduit and the final outflow graft, which will be connected to the ascending aorta. The second one is HeartMate XCV, which has a 65 ml of stroke volume pumping chamber with two mechanical valves, positioned on the anterior abdominal wall with cannulas crossing into the chest wall. It can be either used for left ventricle, right ventricle, or both the ventricles. And it produces a beat rate of 40 to 110 beat per minute with a flow rate of 1.3 to 7.2 liter per minute. And it requires continuous warfarin and aspirin anticoagulation with a target INR range of 2.5 to 3.5. This is the HeartMate 1XV, which is a large device that is present in the that is being placed in the abdomen. The third one is NovaCar. It also consists of a pump drive unit which is implanted in the left upper quadrant of abdomen. Incorporates a dual pusher plate of around 70 ml stroke volume. It contains a sac type blood pump with a smooth blood contacting surface coupled to a pulsed solenoid energy converter drive. Inflow cannula is inserted to the diaphragm into the left ventricular apex, and outflow gap is anastomosed to the ascending aorta. This is INCOR device. This is a first generation device. See how large they are. They contain both the conduit will be pulsating with the walls. So this is an this is the pulsating device, and it will be very discomfortable to the patient because of the huge amount of sound that it will be producing. The next one is a second generation or continuous flow systems. That is the commonly used HeartMate 2 ventricular assist device. The next one is Jarvik 2000. Third one is Berlin Heart INCOR, and fourth one is Micromed Debeke ventricular assist device. HeartMate 2 is a continuous flow axial blood pump with internal rotor with helical blades that curve around a central shaft, and it will be the twisted shape of the outlet stator vanes converts the radial velocity of the blood flow to axial direction, and it can pump a volume of around 10 liter per minute. And it being an axial flow device and an absence of blood sac eliminates the need for venting. This is the HeartMate 2, which is an axial flow device, an axial flow second generation ventricular assist device. See, when compared to the first generation ventricular assist device, the size of the ventricular HeartMate 2 had come down drastically. And the technology also had changed, where the first generation is a pneumatically driven system when compared to the second generation device, which is more of a axial flow system which runs with a motor with rotor blade.
The HeartMate 2 is a small and quiet advanced blood pump designed for improved outcomes with a wide range of late stage heart failure patients in need of reliable long-term circulatory support. 60% smaller than currently approved implanted electric pulsatile LVADs and weighing only 400 grams, the HeartMate 2 incorporates precision engineering, a simple design, and 30 years of clinical experience. It is intended for long-term support as a bridge to transplant or for permanent implant known as destination therapy. The external system components of the HeartMate 2 include a small, flexible percutaneous cable that provides power to the pump and is designed to accommodate patient activity, the system controller, which controls pump operation, and the batteries, which may be conveniently worn in holsters and enable the patient to resume normal daily activities.
Next one is a Jarvik 2000. It is an axial flow continuous pump, flow pump having intraventricular position with whole pump sitting within the LV cavity. It has an impeller, which is the only moving component located in the center of the titanium housing, and blood flow is directed through the outlet draft by stator blades located near the pump, near pump output, and returns either to ascending or the descending aorta. It can pump around 8 liter per minute, and the chance of infections are very rare. This is a Jarvik 2000 second generation axial flow design, which is very small and it hardly weighs around 200 grams. This is how it is being placed within the LV cavity. It is directly placed through the ventricular wall into the LV cavity. And this is an axial system. And because of it directly pumps the blood to the ascending or the descending aorta. Next one is a Berlin Heart INCOR. It is also an axial flow pump, and blood passes into the INCOR. It first passes the inducer that guides laminar flow onto an actual impeller, which is suspended by a magnetic bearing. The advantage of this system is that they have a magnetic bearing, which helps in better transmission of blood through the outflow conduit. The stationary diffuser behind the rotor has specifically aligned beds, which reduce the rotational effect of the blood flow and also creates additional pressure to assist transport of blood into the outflow cannula to the aorta. The fourth one is Micromat Debeke ventricular assist device. It's also an axial flow rotary pump. It consists of elbow-shaped inflow cannula that inserts into the LV cavity. Pumping house unit, which houses the impeller. It is a pumping house which houses the impeller, and it contains a Dacron outflow conduit graft. An ultrasonic flow probe that encircles the outflow valve helps in regulating the circulatory output of the assist device. Then the next one is the recent one is, these are the third generation ventricular assist device. The common ones are the ventricular assist device, ventri assist, and the Dura Hearts. This is how a ventri assist device will be seeing like. It will be, this is the direct inflow region, which will be directly inserted into the left ventricular cavity, and this is the outflow region, which will be directed towards the aorta. This is the HeartMate 3. The inflow part will be directly inserted into the left ventricular cavity, and this is the centrifugal system, which helps in driving the blood from the left ventricular cavity towards the aorta. It will be very small. The major advantage of HeartMate 3 is that it is a very low weight, and it will be
user friendly.
Next one is the total artificial heart. These are the recent technologies where entire heart
is recent. It's nearly 30 years old.
Okay, sir.
That's what I said. See, actually in 1980s, the yes, Jarvik 2000 is there, na?
Yes, sir.
So that fellow was the one who invented this total artificial heart. So he became very popular. And Jarvik, actually he joined the medical school, and after 2 years he left it. He could not say that I can't continue this medical school. So then he did his science graduation and he went for research, and he worked in this assist devices, all those things. And first in the 1980 or 81, he invented this artificial heart. So that artificial heart is a, but that had an external cable, big pump. So patient has to, can move only in the room like that. That was the thing he designed. And that became very popular, and Jarvik became one of the luminaries like that. But subsequently continued his work, and now he has come with, this is a smaller version like that. So in 1980s he came, so he wrote the story of how he left the medical school, then joined the biotechnology group, and then he did research and finally came with the concept of artificial heart.
Total artificial heart is being used where the complete support for severe biventricular failure is required, and in situation where leaving native heart is in place is detrimental, such as in patients with cardiac tumors, severe aortic insufficiency, arrhythmias, left ventricular thrombus, and or an acquired ventricular septal defect. And it is currently approved for biventricular support as bridge to transplant therapy or an imitated device, used device designation for destination therapy. This is how when the presence of the native heart is detrimental to the survival of the patient, a total artificial heart is being planned, in which all the four native walls are being removed. The left and right atrium, aorta and pulmonary artery remain intact. Quick connects are sewn into the left and right atrium, aorta, as well as the pulmonary artery. The syncardia total artificial heart is implanted and attached via four quick connects. And this, when the donor heart becomes available, the syncardia total artificial heart quickly reconnects and removed. And this artificial heart is removed and it's been reconnected with a cardiac transplanted heart. The total adequate intrathoracic space is required with a minimum of body surface area greater than 1.7 meters square with a cardiothoracic ratio greater than 0.5. AP distance of thorax should be at least greater than 10 centimeters with left ventricular diastole dimension greater than 66 mm. And fit anticoagulation is required for all patients with total artificial heart with warfarin, aspirin or pentoxifilin. The common artificial heart that are being used are CardioVest and EbioCard. The contraindication for ventricular assist device therapy on a whole are intolerance to anticoagulation, morbid obesity, right ventricular dysfunction, CKD with serum creatinine greater than 3, restrictive cardiomyopathy, and significant underlying psychiatric illness or lack of social support. The common complications of ventricular assist device can be either divided into systemic complications, cardiac related complications, and left ventricular assist device complications. The first one is systemic complications are common are bleeding risk with acquired von Willebrand syndrome or small bowel AV malformation, thrombosis with increased stroke risk, hemolysis with secondary to destroying blood cells, infection which is the leading cause of death in long-term ventricular assist device support, depression and adjustment disorders. Cardiac related complications are RV dysfunction or failure, closed aortic wall secondary to blood stasis or clot formation, the secondary aortic insufficiency because of lack of adequate valve opening, LV decompression, female gender or small body size. The fourth one is ventricular arrhythmias because of the contact of the inflow cannula with the endocardium. Third category is left ventricular assist device related complications. The most common is the pump thrombosis, which may be rare but very catastrophic, and it is considered in setting of a biventricular dysfunction which presents usually as acute pulmonary edema with hypotension with lab evidence of hemolysis and if the surge in the pump power or decrease in pulsatility index. Next one is device failure or malfunction, highly variable with the type of the device. Increased LVAT afterload, outflow which is secondary to outflow graft kink or obstruction assessed by pullback along the graft or contrast CT angiogram. The fourth one is shutdown. A low preload causes a non-pulsatile ventricular assist device to collapse the ventricle, leads to acute pump thrombosis. And the common post-op surveillance in patients with a left ventricular assist device is clinical assessment regularly, echocardiography, right heart catheterization if required, and adjustment of vasodilators, diuretics, and pump parameters with time-to-time basis. To conclude, left ventricular assist device is the future of end-stage heart failure patients. It helps in improving the quality of life in patients with heart failure, improving the survival, can either act as a bridge to transplantation or a final destination therapy. This is just a brief and takeover from all the devices. This is the initial devices which are very heavy, which are usually paracorporeal, which worked as within pneumatic systems, which are pulsatile. It can be used either a univentricular or biventricular system, biventricular devices. Then it is replaced by the implantable, electrical, pulsatile, large, with multiple moving parts which are being placed in the abdomen. And slowly these are being replaced by an implantable, electric, continuous flow axial designs which are smaller and single moving part with the only rotor that is being moved. This is HeartMate 2 and this is further replaced by the HeartMate 3 which are implantable, electric and these are also a continuous flow but with centrifugal design, which are smaller and with lack no bearings. These are further being replaced by the further smaller device such as Ventri Assist 5, which are implantable, electric continuous flow design, continuous flow systems with axial design, which are further smaller with partial support only. Thank you.
Okay, good. Actually, Jarvik, I told in 1981 or 82, he invented that first. It was a big epoch-making study like that. And so after 1 or 2 years, one patient survived for 6 months like that. Then it went into little this one backstays because of the same and common complications, all those things. But he continued to work on that. Now, after the advent of this assist devices, rather than artificial heart, the assist devices are more user-friendly and more useful than, because artificial heart is a major surgery you have to do. And one more thing is, probably if you get a transplant, undoing that and doing a transplant is a very tough problem. Whereas in these assist devices, you can go for transplant whenever you want, when it's available like that. So sometimes they ask like that LV assist devices, or they ask like assist impeller or heart mate, or they may write about our total artificial heart like that.
Yes, sir.
No, you have to know the concept and the major things, and that's enough. Nobody wants in detail how, see, you have to write whether it is an axial flow or a centrifugal flow, whether it is a this one, and that's enough. You can put a line diagram showing that how the input and output come like that. That's, and that will give us the concept. Major thing is, as I said, infection is a major problem because of the damage to the skin, subcutaneous tissue, all those things. So all the commensals or whatever they in the skin will enter and cause all problems. Even though you're keeping it sterile, but tough.